About the title, I'm sure that some of you are wondering why the evolution of humanity is referred to as the human experiment. The textbook title is intended to emphasize a scientific understanding that the appearance of our species on the planet was not inevitable. Humans have no inherent right to exist, and we have no guarantee of our long-term survival. Although scientists would not say that evolution is random, the appearance and disappearance of a particular species has not occurred in a way that would seem to indicate the existence of a grand plan that would necessarily lead and explain the existence of humans. We are just one of thousands of species that have benefited by being able to respond to an opportunity provided by nature. Most of the species have existed on Earth are already extinct. All of today's modern humans are descended from a very small ancestral population numbering perhaps as few as 600 breeding individuals. That population nearly became extinct about 140,000 years ago. Due to the demands of severe climate change, we don't know what the future will hold in terms of climate change, large-scale migration, the spread of diseases and other conditions to which we will need to adapt. Each adaptive response humans have made during our existence, whether by biological evolution or cultural change, have essentially been experiments in adaptation. And this will continue to be the case in the future. We have been fortunate so far, but we have also had help. Although it may not seem like it today, humans have always been dependent on nature, on natural resources, and other organisms. The earliest hominins who became human did so by discovering fire and inventing tools while inheriting and then influencing key aspects of the human biology, such as enhanced cognition and bipedal locomotion, which permitted cultural change throughout the process of becoming human. We have always interacted with aspects of nature that are non-human: food, medicinal resources, stone, clay, etc. Some Native American cultures, such as the Mescalero Apaches, go so far as to explicitly identify humans as the weakest of the beings that inhabit the earth, who are therefore reliant on their more capable animal relatives. Thus, when discussing human development, we are speaking of bicultural evolution, a process by which biological and cultural changes are triggered, conditioned and redirected by the interplay of biological change and human agency in the earliest parts of our ancestry. Change was dominated by a biological process and was very much dependent on non-human influences. One might say that early humanity was an experiment that grew out of the operation of the processes of nature. In more recent times, change has involved greater human agency, but also working in concert with nature in complex ways. So the invention of plant domestication or hierarchical socio-political systems that characterize complex societies are biological or social experiments devised by us. To the extent that human actions have effects on other species such as food crops, insects, pests, and animals that thrive in human-altered habitats. We are also conducting experiments in co-evolution. We cannot predict the future, so we don't know what changes we will encounter or what the outcome of these experiments will be. We can get some ideas by looking at the overall trajectory of human existence and by examining the successes and failures of earlier species and societies. but we are really living in an ongoing experiment. That is the end of chapter 1, part 2.